Okay, good morning everyone.
Good morning.
It gives me great pleasure to welcome all of you for the opening ceremony this morning to 1 week short term training program on IoT and advanced power electronic applications in smart grid. It is jointly sponsored by AICT, All India Council for Technical Education, under Quality Improvement Scheme and KKWAG Engineering Education and Research Center, Nasik. I welcome the honorable chief guest, Professor Dr. H.M. Suryavanshi sir, Principal Professor Dr. K.N. Nandurkar sir, Head of Department Professor Dr. B.E. Kushare sir, faculty members and all the participants from all over India, various European and Asian countries. I thank all of you for accepting our invitation. Again, I welcome you all for joining this inauguration ceremony. And it's a great pleasure to have more than 970 plus participants with us today. And we miss our beloved president of KKWAG Education Society, Honorable Shri Balasaheb D.Wag, who is very supportive for such activities, but he is unable to be here with us today due to other engagements. So now moving on to this session, the Internet of Things, IoT, it's a connection of people and things at any time, in any place, with anyone and anything, using any network and any service. Thus, IoT is a huge dynamic global network infrastructure of internet-enabled entities with web services. One of the most important applications of IoT is the smart grid. Smart grid is a data communication network which is integrated with the power grid to collect and analyze data that are required from transmission lines, distribution substation, and consumers. Advancement in power electronic technology provides an opportunity approach for such purpose like smart grid. Electrical vehicle technologies, power quality improvements, flexible AC transmission systems, and high voltage DC transmission system technology. So in this and the upcoming sessions for the next 5 days, we'll be talking about the IoT, smart grid, and the advancement in power electronics and their relationships. Some IoT structures in smart grid, requirements and applications for using IoT in smart grid, and challenges and future work will be briefed in this 5 days STTP. So again, a warm welcome to everyone. Now I would request our principal, Professor Dr. K.N. Nandurkar sir, to please brief about the institute.
Yes, thank you, madam. Honorable Professor Suryavanshi, Dr. B.E. Kushare, all the participants of this 1 week program, which is sponsored by AICT. On behalf of the institute, I welcome you all for this particular session. I'm really happy to be with all of you today. Maybe in the online mode, we could not meet physically because of the current situation. But anyway, the response is very good, and I really appreciate the interest of all the participants in joining this particular program and taking advantage of this very important topic, which is very relevant today. We are talking about IoT and smart grid applications, and I think that will be very useful for all the participants. Just to begin with, let me tell you something about the organizing institute. We are a part of KKWAG Education Society. This society was started 50 years back. Now we are in the golden jubilee year. It was started with a small school in the rural area. And in those days, the school was for girl students in that rural area. And then the society expanded later on. In 1983, we started the Polytechnic first. And in 84, this engineering college was started. At that time, only 3 branches were there, but today we have 8 branches in 4 departments. We have PG program plus 4 departments are having PhD program. And I'm really glad to share with you that 15 candidates have completed their PhD so far. I think that is remarkable for an unaided institute in an area like Nasik. This institute is also accredited by NAC with grade A. And recently our 8 departments, they got accredited by NBA. This was probably important achievement for our institute, because there are very few institutes which are having simultaneously 8 departments accredited. And this was the 3rd cycle of accreditation for this institute. Of course, there are so many other achievements at society level. We have now 35 institutes, which includes all schools and colleges. We have Polytechnic, Pharmacy College, B.Ed. College, Fine Art, Performing Art College. There are 6 agriculture colleges. And of course, our traditional BSc, BCom, and MSc program that also we are running. So overall, there are 35 institutes, more than 20,000 students are studying, and more than 2,000 faculty or staff members are working with this KKWAG Education Society. So now we are offering education right from KG to PhD program in various branches of study or faculties. And that is really a remarkable thing to happen. That is, we can have a lot of interdisciplinary interaction among our departments and other institutes. So that is what is happening. And this is a well-known institute, not only in Maharashtra, but at national level. Because in 2016, when the NIRF was declared, our institute was declared 85th rank in the country. So that shows the potential of the institute, the potential of the teaching learning process, and how we are carrying out the activities in a very quality related manner. Now, every department of this institute has taken up this initiative to have some activities in the relevant field. And of course, electrical department has been always on the forefront to talk about the topics, not only which are relevant today, but which are relevant in the future. And it has been always our effort at KKWAC to conduct this type of programs and inform people or create awareness about these technologies, not only among the academicians, but among the industry people also. And every time we get a good response from industry participants, and they are also very happy to know some new things which are happening in the field of technology, and that is shared by some academic institute. Generally, we find that there is a gap between academia and industry, but at KKWAC, we are trying to bridge this gap. There is a good interaction with the industries, and we are also talking of the same technologies which they are using in the industry. So I think that is a very good blend of industry academia effort, which is done by KKWAC. And of course, we get so many programs sponsored by university and AICT. This is one of the programs, and I'm really glad that participants, not only from this country, but from different countries in Asia, they are also participating in this. So I think it will be a very good interaction. I appeal all the participants to be very attentive and ask questions, relevant questions, wherever there is possible. So it will be an interactive type of session. You can learn more out of that and gain something. The takeaway should be that you must be able to apply something at your place, maybe in your research or your activity or whatever you are doing, or even in teaching, if you can add something more and give value addition to the students, I think that will be the success of this program. My best wishes to all the panelists and all the participants. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now I request our HOD, Professor Dr. B. Kushare, sir, to brief about the department and the event.
Good morning to all. First of all, I'm thankful to Professor Suryavanshi for accepting our invitation. He's a well-known academician, a researcher, and technocrat. So thank you very much, sir, for association with the department. Professor Nandurkar, sir, all faculty members, and all my dear participants. So electrical engineering department, the journey started in 95-96. And then initially we started with Intake 40. And today if you look into, we are running two divisions, division A and B, as far as the UG program is concerned, with the intake of total 16 to 120. Well, two PG programs, but presently we are running only power system and research center. See, our department is well known as far as organizing the various event for faculty development, to train industry personnel, as well as to offer the consultancy services to various industries in various sectors, such as power quality, energy, design, condition monitoring, and so on. During COVID also, we organized many webinars, and I'm happy to share that the participation in one of the webinar crossed 2,000, and many people across the globe, even there were participants from other countries, they attended, and finally, I always appeal to everyone that COVID provided us opportunity to think in different manner. And COVID should not be considered as a threat. COVID should be considered as an opportunity, because COVID will enable us, or it will compel us basically to switch over to the smart technologies. Because when we talk about the conventional technologies, everyone is aware, energy conversion, transfer, storage devices, monitoring devices, sensors, they were in place, but they were connected maybe at local level, integrated at local level. But today, what we will see in immediate future, or I'll say that already it is happening across the world, that the sensors, energy conversion devices, as well as basically the monitoring, everything is switching over to smart kind of thing. Sensors are smart. Intelligence is brought into in a big way, because today no one is interested in just capturing the data, and knowledge support, decision support systems are going to be the future of the country. Because whatever previous monitoring system was there, even monitoring IoT was already there, because you are aware when it, whether it comes to the power quality energy monitoring or many times basically the health monitoring, data was getting captured. And no doubt the abnormal situation was being communicated. But the biggest problem was the person who was dealing with those concern areas was not basically having the expertise to act. So today, everyone is expecting that no doubt I should understand what is the problem, but at the same time, I should get a prescription, what action needs to be done. And I think this IoT-based technologies, power electronics is going to play a very key role. Sensors are going to play a very, key role. And everyone need to understand machine learning and artificial intelligence is going to be the important aspect. And merger of all these streams is going to take us to a level that everything will be smart. And when you talk about IoT, it is internet of everything. And that is future. And that's why we as a faculty member, we need to understand that the application softwares or the integration in a very cost-effective manner is going to be the one of the area for we as an academician as well as researcher to contribute. And I'll say this particular area provided a solution which is very easily adaptable. I'll give you one simple example. IoT-enabled devices, even in home automation, they are already launched across the world. Even they are used in India. What is the advantage of that? You are not required to change your present infrastructure. I'll give an example. Suppose you are required to implement this IoT-based application in your home for home automation purpose. What you are required to simply do is just replace the old switches by IoT-enabled switches. There will be hotspot created locally. It will have multiple redundancy, and you can transform or you can basically take your home electrical distribution system to the IoT-enabled system. So I think this is the future. I'll say this is the present and future as well. And no doubt, the artificial intelligence will be taken to the human intelligence level, and there everyone will understand what level will go for basically the industrial systems. Industry 4.0 program is already implemented in developed countries, in India also. Lot of industries, even I'll say that small scale industries, they are going for Industry 4.0. We as an academician, as a researcher, our contribution needs to be that how we'll provide solutions and services in artificial intelligence and machine learning, because that is going to decide which country, which academic institution or researcher is going to lead in this particular area. I'm really thankful to all the faculty or resource persons, because all faculty and resource persons, you'll find they are the stalwart in their area. They are doing a lot of research. And this next 5 days program, I'll say that all professional, the academicians, industry personnel, they are attending this session. So when we are referring to STTP or workshop, I think this should become a learning session to all. I'll request participant that provide us an opportunity as a resource person to learn out of this. And I think if it becomes a learning session for everyone, definitely we'll be happy that the outcome of this session is going to create a different kind of momentum. So again, thank you very much, all participants. And I'll request everyone to contribute actively. And at the end of this session, there should be a takeaway that everyone will get basically something to work on and contribute on. Thank you all. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your kind words. I'm sure that all participants will take the benefit of this opportunity to learn these new technologies, and looking forward to this event. Now we'll move on to the day one, the session one of the day one. I'll hand over the charge to my colleague. So with all your permission, we'll start with the session one. Hello, good morning to one and all. Naina Jangle, welcome once again our today's chief guest and speaker of the first session, Professor Dr. H.M. Suryavanshi, sir. I'm happy to introduce our today's eminent speaker. I take a great opportunity to introduce the speaker, Professor Dr. H.M. Suryavanshi, sir. He received the BE degree in Electrical Engineering from Walchand College of Engineering, Sangli, India in 1988, and MA degree in Electrical Engineering from Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore in 1994. He has been awarded PhD degree by Nagpur University in 1999. He is currently working as a professor in the Department of Electrical Engineering, Vishweshwaraya National Institute of Technology, Nagpur, and chair professor of Indian National Academy of Engineering, INAE. He is also work as HOD and Dean RNC. He is an associate editor of IEEE Transaction on Industrial Electronics. He has received Fellow of Indian National Academy of Engineering, FNAE, in 2012 for his outstanding research. He has received the Bimal Bose Award in 2009 and Biman Behari Sen Memorial Award in 2017 from IETE for his leadership in power electronics in India and for Distinguished Contribution Outstanding Achievements Award from Energy Society of India and Pondicherry Engineering College, Government of Pondicherry. He is a senior member of IEEE USA, Fellow of Institution of Engineer India, Fellow of IETE India. He is a regular reviewer of IEEE Transaction on Industrial Electronics, IEEE Transaction on Power Electronics and IEEE Proceedings, Power Electronics and Electric Power Applications. He has more than 200 SCI publications with a citation of around 2,400 in various reputed journals. He has also completed many projects sponsored by DST, MHRD, CDAC, and many more industries. He has 15 patents published. Also, he has developed many products such as soft switching converter, high power factor converter for UPS system, three-phase modular resonant converter for DC applications, and many more products. He has guided 20 PhD scholars and around 32 PG projects. We are really honored to have you, sir, in this session. Before we get started, a few instructions for all the participants. If you have any questions during the presentation, please type them into question box. We will bring them up during the presentation and we'll also have time for question at the end. Now I request Professor Dr. H.M. Suryavanshi sir to start our first session of this workshop. Okay. Welcome, sir.
Well, thank you. So 1 minute, I have to share the screen.
Yes, sir.
Screen, it can be shared.
Hi. Thank you, Nandi. Just a minute, sir. Okay. I'm sharing. Okay.
Screen is visible? Hello? Screen is visible?
Yes, sir. Screen is visible.
Okay, now it's okay.
Yes, sir, full screen is required.
Okay.
Yes, sir, it's now.
First of all, thank you very much for inviting me for the IoT and advanced power electronic in Smart Grid. The power electronic is one of the component for the Smart Grid. Without power electronics, Smart Grid is dull because all major power from source to load is transferred to the converters. Converter play a very important role for transportation of power. For the control of the converters, IoT and communication both are essential for remote locations. You cannot visit to the remote location every time. So therefore, IoT communications are essential part of the power electronic and similarly control also. So therefore, so I have taken a topic, small topic, so different design step for the converters, how to design the converters. Any converter, whether AC to DC, DC to AC, AC to DC or DC to AC, for example, packed devices. For packed devices also, to control the power, maybe reactive power or the active power, or the active filters also to mitigate the harmonics also. So any converter, if you design, so basic knowledge of design of converter is essential. For this, so I am going here step by step for design of the converters, different steps. For example, specification of converters. Without specification of converters, you cannot design the converters. There are different components of the specifications. So we'll go one by one. Specification of converter. Then the selection of power semiconductor switches. How to select the switches? For example, particular power level. Which switches is most suitable? Either MOSFET, IGBT, silicon carbide device, NAND devices, IGCT. There are various power electronic component. And for particular level, which semiconductor power level particularly, which semiconductor switches is most suitable? This is the very important factor. We cannot use always IGBT or some higher power devices. So power level is must to choose the specification important. Then selection of magnetic materials. There is nowadays large of magnetic materials are available, particularly earlier only two magnetic material are available, only CRGO and ferrite core. Nowadays amorphous core, then lot of magnetic core, MPP core, Sandus core, Kulmu core, and so on, various type of available. These are magnetic material very essential, and flux density also high. Operating frequency is very high. Temperature, the operating temperature is good, very good. So therefore selection of magnetic material is very important, also to reduce the core losses also. Then selection of the core, after selecting the core of magnetic material, you have to design the inductor or transformer. For designing the inductor and transformer, we need the leads wire. For high frequency, or flat foil also used for design of inductor and transformer. Then selection of the capacitor. Capacitor is so various types is available nowadays. Very good dielectrics material. That is maybe a Teflon, polypropylene capacitor, MLCC capacitor, multilayer ceramic capacitor is also available. Lot of magnetic material. Lot of capacitor available. That good temperature, good frequency, low loss. Then fourth point is design of snubber circuit. Many power electronics circuit does not require snubber circuit, but some of the manufacturer use this snubber circuit because to reduce the losses, but is not essential. If you proper design of the converter, this snubber circuit is not required. Then design of heat sink. To take out the heat or to absorb the heat from the device's junction, so heat sink is device. Many cases nowadays heat sink is not required. Very small heat sink are sufficient in many design cases because of proper design and to reduce the losses. Why the power electronic uses? The reason is the efficient control, power conditioning, and the heat control also. But efficiency is very important factor. Later, design of the gate driver circuit to reduce the switching losses. Gate driver circuit is essential. So these parameters, this circuit is essential. Design of filter, generally for filter amorphous cores are used. Then closed loop control. Without closed loop, the system is null. Therefore, closed loop is important finally. So we'll go one by one. So all those parameter is not possible here. So whatever time permit, up to that we'll discuss the material. Then power electronic, first we'll just now discuss the efficiency, efficient control and conditioning of electric. And all those is possible only use of static means, that is the power electronic converters. So what is our goal? To flow the power or to transport the power from source to load. This is possible with accurate control, efficient control using converters only. So source to load. So thermal, there are different energy sources, thermal, hydro, nuclear, wind, solar, tidal, other, etc. These are source. And load, you know the load also, industry, domestic, public, transport, and others. There are four converters. So rectifier, then DC to DC converter, sometime it is called chopper also, but nowadays chopper is not called because of the high power level. It is the DC to DC converter is called only, then inverters. And cyclo converter, instead of cyclo converter, nowadays use is the matrix converters, and then rectifiers. All this four converter play an important role. So all four converter together is called converters only. Whether it is AC to DC, DC to DC, or AC to AC, this is a converters only. Next is the converter application. There are different type of applications. For example, domestic application, fan, television, washing machine, and so on. Transport is the heavy power, heavy load, locomotive, ropeways, conveyor belt, etc. Communication used generally for communication purpose, to communicate to each other, or the telephone system, mobile charger, PA system, satellite antenna, etc. So drives, one of the major applications also for the industry purpose, for the motor control especially. Then pack devices now play very important roles. Professor Kushare know better than me about the pack devices. He know how to compensate the reactive power, then control the active power, and there are various devices that come, SSC, unified power flow controller, UPQC, PSC, power active filter, HVDC, and so on, many more pack devices. Therefore, accurate design of the controller and accurate design of the power electronic circuit, that is hardware, is the essential part nowadays. So let us start the specification of the converters. So everybody will know the what is the specifications. So power rating is the essential part. After the power rating, voltage and current rating, then switching frequency and applications. Application means where you are using, whether the drives application or pack devices or the some small converters, or what is the operating temperature range, that is the ambient temperature, according to you can design the converters also. So these parts are essential. So how to select the converters? So voltage rating, so current rating. So you cannot take higher voltage and higher current rating as per a specification of the semiconductor devices. You have to scale down the voltage rating and current rating. Scaling down means not actually scale down, but it is actually derating the device. What is mean by derating? For example, 1000 volt and 1000 ampere device. So you have to derate, it is 50 to 60%. If you have to derate 40%, then it is 600 volt and 600 ampere instead of 1000. So remember, this is derating is essential to keep the devices operating for the longer time and in the ambient environment. Then come to the switching frequency. Switching frequency is very important part to run the devices, to reduce the ripple in the output waveform and voltage. So that is called the shaping of the devices, shaping of the output voltage and current waveform. So therefore, more the switching frequency, smaller the size of the inductor and transformer and capacitor. So this is the inversely proportional to the frequency size. Then selection of power semiconductor devices, which power semiconductor device is good for particular power level, If you operate at the lab level, very small power level, then which device should be used? For HVDC, which device is more suitable? See here the MOSFET. This is the vertical axis is the voltage. A Y axis, X axis is current. And the third axis I have drawn here is the frequency, operating frequency. See the one by one devices is the MOSFET is the small power level device. Small area indicate the power level. That is the losses indicate the either losses or power level. Voltage and current is the power. Then next to the MOSFET is the IGBT. Now IGBT, then BJT. Now high voltage IGBT, high current IGBT is available nowadays. This is the power level. Now the IGBT can go the 4000 volt and 3500 volt. Here will come now a high voltage IGBT device. Then IGCT, that is the gate commutated thyristor, integrated gate commutated thyristor. This is a nothing but the thyristor, very similar to only control. You can fully control device. You can control during on and off. Then GTO. So GTO has a small problem, that is the turn off current is 30% of the full load current. For example, 1000 ampere current device, so you need actually 300 more than 300. So for example, it is 20%, so 1000 into 10, so it is around 200 ampere current is required. 20%, if 30% is also required sometime. Then thyristor is still higher power devices among the all devices. And this axis is given here, frequency axis. So you can see the MOSFET can be operate very few megahertz. Then IGBT, high speed IGBT, that is can be operate up to the 400 kilohertz. Then high voltage IGBT, 20 kilohertz. IGCT up to 20 kilohertz. GTO you can operate up to 10 kilohertz. This is a maximum switching frequency. And thyristor up to 1 kilohertz to 10 kilohertz also. This is the operating frequency range of the devices. So here we have taken one example. We have calculated the losses, total losses in the laboratory. So for this purpose, we have selected 8 devices. We have selected 8 devices. Was selected 8 devices. 1 minute, huh? I have to take the spotlight. Okay, now it is come. So here 8 devices selected. 4 are MOSFET and 4 IGBT. Here 2 kilowatt power level we are considered for verifications. For 2 kilowatt power level, which device is better? I am not talking very high power level. So 2 kilowatt here consider. And check whether the MOSFET is good or the IGBT is good. We have to verify whether the for 2 kilowatt, which is better. Otherwise, the selection of the wrong devices, efficiency will fall down and the size of the converters is increased. This is not a good practice. Before that, we have to check which device is good for the 2 power level. It is a very essential component. Now I selected MOSFET and IGBT both together and we are comparing the 8 devices, 4 MOSFET and 4 IGBT. See that the conduction loss for the MOSFET depend upon the on-state resistance and conduction loss of the IGBT depend upon on-state voltage. So this data will be provided by the manufacturer. If you go to the any side of the manufacturer data book, so you will get the data book. On-state resistance of the MOSFET, that is called RDS, and on-state voltage. So that will decide the on-state resistance. Generally, on-state resistance is represented RDS. This RDS. 1 minute. RDS. RDS is represent is not working properly. Okay, doesn't matter. Here I will draw with the help of mouse only. Mouse is not possible, was good. Okay, is RDS is represent onset resistance of the MOSFET. Okay, so according to the data manufacturer, so this RDS, I square R losses, conduction losses on onset is voltage into current in IGBT. Now take one by one. In selecting the one by one, so selecting the one by one, so we have to go hardware implementation. After the hardware implementations, we find that total losses, including switching losses also. Switching losses is depend upon the frequency and voltage and current magnitude. Higher the switching frequency, higher the switching losses. Also depend on voltage, magnitude of voltage and current also. So let us see here device one. So we have plotted total dies conduction losses plus the switching losses. This is the characteristic one. Then selection of the device two. See the characteristic total losses characteristic two number here. Then third MOSFET. This and fourth MOSFET. This is the fourth. This is fourth. Out of this four MOSFET, if you select wrong device, what will happen? Losses is more. For example, you have selected the device 3. For example, same voltage rating, same current rating. So if you have selected device 3, what will happen? You will get 15 watt loss. Why? Reason is RDS on state resistance is more. Similarly, is switching line, switching parameter, that is the on time current and off time current. These two parameter is also high. Therefore, total losses is very high. If you select for three, if you select one device, so you will get. So question is arise, are this plot to be plot every time is essential? No. Why? Data manufacturer will provide you many parameters. One of the parameter data manufacturer will provide you, that is the on-state resistance of the device. Select the device which have lower conduction loss means lower on-state resistance, right? Lower on-state resistance means lower conduction losses. So select out of these four devices which is the lower on-state resistance. Next question arises, how to reduce the switching losses? Sometimes switching losses is more than conduction losses also, that is possible. So you select the device such that which has a very low on-state resistance and on-state current. You have to select the device such that which has a lower switching losses and lower conduction losses. What is the switching losses? Total timing, that is T on time, T on and plus T off. This is the total switching time. This is switching time. So again, T off. Again, T off equal to so some problem has come. Oh, okay, I am trying to solve this problem. This is not going in. Okay, now it's come back. Okay. It's okay. It's now normalized. So total time is T on. T on is further divided. T on is further divided into two parts. That is the rise time and delay on time. Similarly, T off also divided into two parts, fall time and TD off. These are the four time that is data book manufacturer will provide the in data book. So you have to remember this timing. Smaller the timing, generally timing in nanoseconds. very, very nanosecond small. I will show you next few slide. So see here, now if you take the IGBT for device 5, see the here, device 5, this is the characteristic, device 5, this is characteristic, that is the increase, loss is increasing. Device 6, this is the losses of device 6, that is the 7, this is for 7, and for 8, this is the for 8. Now out of 8 devices, whether the MOSFET is good or IGBT is good, basic question is good. We have to see the least losses, total losses. We have to see both including switching losses as well as conduction losses. So as per data book, we find that is the 450, IRFP 450 is the best devices for lower losses for the switching frequency up to 250 kilohertz or more than that. This is the way of selecting, but it is not essential to plot this characteristic everything. Only remember device onset resistance for MOSFET and device onset voltage for the IGBT for conduction losses. For switching losses, I am repeating again, for switching losses, turn on time and turn off time. This you have to see the minimum. Okay. Then next slide. This slide is not changing now. Okay. Maybe some problem with this dot. Okay. Now see here, this is the applications where the particular device is used. This is the diagram from Ned Mohan book. So here power capacity is given, x, y axis and x axis switching frequency is very essential part of the converter. And various applications of the device is also here taken. The application, for example, small power level, maybe VCR, or the switching power supply for the computers, yes, switch mode power supply for computers, that is the MOSFET used, discrete MOSFET for car, very small power level. If you go higher power level, so you will get the motor control, if large UPS, robot, so you will get the IGBT. Then if you shift further, so that is transistor module, but nowadays transistor is not used because of the base, heavy base current is required. Then the for the GTO, for the traction, electric car, UPS also. Then come to the thyristor, again the very high power level device used for the HVDC. Still people are using HVDC purpose. Nowadays, after few years, the MOSFET is replaced the thyristor also. So now then in addition to this, various devices available, silicon carbide devices and GaN devices. GaN device means gallium nitride devices and silicon carbide devices, that is called SiC. In many applications, these silicon carbide devices is replacing the IGBT also, because gallium nitride devices and the silicon very fast devices and very high bandwidth, high operating temperatures, these devices. Silicon carbide devices available up to the 3700 volt and the 400 ampere, very high power available now silicon carbide devices. But gallium nitride devices are available up to the 650 volt, that is the limitations of the gallium nitride. But very high speed devices and very rugged devices, both are, these are the very good devices. Next, see here, this characteristic shown here is very important characteristic. This characteristic shown here is the output characteristic of IGBT, MOSFET or transistor is similar. So reason is, this characteristic is show the three reason. One of the reason, that is called saturation reason. This is dotted line and this y-axis, the dotted light current is saturation region. Three axis here, so current, collector current, and the x axis is collector to emitter voltage, and control parameter gate to emitter voltage. You can see here, control parameter gate to emitter voltage, right? So three reason here. One, saturation reason. And second is cutoff reason. This is the portion cutoff reason. Third is, active reason. And the third is the cutoff reason. Cutoff reason is generally current is zero. Voltage may be there, but current is zero. No current. And if you exceed the vertically, so control parameter, higher the gate voltage, higher will the current will flow. Higher the gate voltage, higher is the current. So here, you have to select saturation region in operating mode. Why? Reason is that in saturation region, on-state resistance is low. Why on-state resistance low? You can see here slope of the device, slope of the characteristic. You can see here slope of this characteristic. Slope of the characteristic is very, very small. That is the delta V by delta I. See here the slope. See, I am drawing here. This is the slope. Here the delta V. Here the delta V will be here. Delta V is not writing correctly. Delta V by delta I. Here some problem with the writing also. Delta I. Okay. Delta V by delta I. I will write here delta V by delta I. This is the slope. And this slope is represent on state resistance, that is RDS. This slope is represent RDS. This is very small. Why it is small? Because delta V is small. This is the delta V. Delta V is small. And delta I is very large. This is the delta I. This portion is delta I. This portion is delta I. So therefore, delta I is larger than delta I, so small. Another you can see, if you operate in active region, what will problem? Here the large change in voltage, small change in current. Here the large change in voltage and small change in current. So this is the parameter here. Again, I'll go to the pane. So see here, this is small change in current, but large change in voltage up to this. I have not drawn correctly. This is. So small change in current, large change in voltage. So large change in voltage, small change, this slope is large. Slope is large in active region, and in saturation region is small. Smaller the resistance, smaller is the I square R losses. This is the advantage operating in the saturation region. So this characteristic is very, very useful for the device selections, particularly conduction losses. Particularly to the conduction losses. Next slide. We have taken two devices as the 2 kilowatt power level. Two devices at 2 kilowatt. One is the MOSFET, another is the IGBT. So these two devices were taken for the power level 2 kilowatt operating range. See here the MOSFET. This MOSFET is 650 volt. On state resistance is 0.1 ohm. And the drain current for the MOSFET is 35 ampere. And the package is TO245. Here is also package TO245. Preferred about 2 kilowatt. Then 600 volt, very near to this. Current is also near to this. and the on-state resistance is 2.5. This is about the comparison of the device. Both devices selected at the same power level, operating with the same power level. Now we have to see the advantage and disadvantage at particular power, which is the base device, which has the lower losses also. Now let us see the next slide. In the next slide, see here, this is about the selection for the conduction losses. RDS should be minimum. See here, RDS on-state resistance is minimum and the on-state voltage for the MOSFET, IGBT is minimum. So next, the after conduction loss, we have to decide the switching losses is also. Now for the switching losses, we have selected timing is also data book will provide you. So this is the delay turn time, that 10 nanosecond, rise time 5 nanosecond, and delay of time 70 nanoseconds. Okay. Then TD of 70 nanosecond and fall time 10 nanosecond. This is the total on time and total off time. If you collect together this four timing, so you will get the 95 approximately or 95 nanoseconds. But problem is 95 nanoseconds is very good, but problem with the other side, you can see very clearly IGBT side. TD delay time, on time delay 30 nanoseconds, rise time 26 nanoseconds, and delay time 140 nanoseconds. Delay out and the fall time 15. If you select together, is at least four to five times. So therefore, switching losses in IGBT is more for particular power level. Remember, I am talking for particular power level, not at all cases will be same. Remember, switching losses in IGBT is more and MOSFET is very, very small. Conduction losses is also, you can see RDS is very, very small, 0.1 ohm. We have to verify now where the conduction losses is. Now we have to take the 10 ampere 50% of the load. Let us see the faintest resistor of 20 ampere. We are 10 ampere we have selected. So now for the 10 ampere current rating, so MOSFET, what is the conduction losses for the MOSFET? I square RDS. What is I? We have taken 10 ampere. So 10 square into 0.1 ampere. So that is equal to 10. What is the power loss? But if you select the IGBT, so what is the conduction loss for the IGBT? VC is the on-state voltage and IC is the current. So we have selected on-state voltage is 2.5 and current is 10 ampere. Product is 25 ampere. This product is 25 ampere. Here, 25 ampere. For case 2, suppose 2 MOSFET is connected in parallel instead of 1. What will it affect? What will happen in the MOSFET and IGBT? For example, 5 ampere each. 10 ampere is divided into 5 ampere, parallel connection of the 2 MOSFET. So what is the loss for the first MOSFET and loss for second MOSFET? See here, for first MOSFET, I square RDS, 5 square into 0.1, 2.5 ampere, okay? So here, 2.5 watt. Then for second MOSFET, also I square RDS, that is 5 square into 0.1, 2.5 watt. Losses. What is the total losses? 1 plus 2, that is 2.5 plus 2.5 equal to 5 watt. Total losses is 5 watt. This is the losses. Now losses is decreased from state graph. Losses is decreased from 10 watt to 5 watt in MOSFET. Now similarly, you can see in IGBT 5 ampere divided again losses for the first IGBT 2.5 is the onset voltage into 5 ampere into 5 ampere 12.5 watt. Okay. Now second IGBT 2.5 into 5 again 12.5. What is the losses using total 1+2 1+2 12.5 + 12.20. Losses remains same. No advantages. Conduction losses is less. Switching losses is here as compared to MOSFET is high. So plus 25 watt plus if you add again, switching losses is more because two devices connected in parallel. But here the switching losses is not high. Reason is switching timing. You can see the switching timing is very, very less as compared to IGBT. Therefore, switching losses is less here. Conduction losses is reduced for parallel connection. This is one of the advantages. So anybody having a question on this topic, I will move to the another topic, that is the magnetic material. Now after this, different type of magnetic material available. Anybody having the question now, they can ask to the question to the me. Or I can move to the another topic.
Sir, you move towards the next topic. So we will take the question answer in last session.
That okay, good.
Because no, it I will mean set.
Yeah. I correct.
Okay, sir.
Okay. I'll take another. Pick 1 minute. Please wait. I will close this PPT.
Yes, sir. Okay.
Now screen is visible?
Yes, sir. Screen is visible.
Okay, good. Now different type of magnetic material, selection of the magnetic material, how to select the magnetic material is the very important topic again, because many of them unknown about the magnetic material. Large number of magnetic material available now. You are very lucky. Earlier only our time, only ferrite core and the CRGO core is available. Amorphous core is also not available at that time when I was doing my research work during PhD work. So now you are lucky, very large number of devices, large number of capacitor, large number of magnetic material, everything is in bulk is available for you. So let us start here. Magnetic material for power electronic, different shape and sizes of the magnetic material. First, see the which type of magnetic material generally for to design the transformer and the inductor. So which type of magnetic material, what is their properties? So property should be high relative permeability. What is the relative permeability means? More conductivity for the flux. For example, in electrical circuit, conductivity is sigma to conduct or to pass the current. That means low resistance, means more conductivity. But in this case, relative permeability play an important role for the conductivity of the flux. That is current in equivalent in the electrical circuit. Then what is the next parameter? That is saturation flux density. B saturation flux density should be high. Higher the saturation flux density, lower the size of transformer and inductor. And for higher current, transformer and will not saturate, inductor will not saturate. It's the advantage. Low coercive force means there should be a low coercive force to pass the current. High electrical resistivity means eddy current losses is less. Higher the electrical resistivity means lesser the eddy current loss. This is the important parameter. The next parameters, the high temperature, Curie temperature, operating temperature, low hysteresis and eddy current loss per unit volume area. So these parameters are very essential for the magnetic material. Then in general, there are three categories of the magnetic material: diamagnetic, paramagnetic, and ferromagnetic. Generally, we will prefer ferromagnetic material because permeability is very high, in the range 10 to 1 lakh. Therefore, ferromagnetic use. For diamagnetic material, permeability, relative permeability is very, very less. Paramagnetic is slightly greater than 1. So, only ferromagnetic material is more suitable for us to design the inductor and the transformer. Let us see the ferromagnetic material, BH core, ferromagnetic at the top, diamagnetic material, then free space, that is the air, and the paramagnetic material. These are the BH core approximately. So therefore, this is the ferromagnetic material selected for inductor and transformer in generally power electronic circuit. Now, what are the ferromagnetic material different type? There are two type, is the hard magnetic and soft magnetic material. These two material play a very important role in power electronic and manufacturer of machine, maybe transformer, induction motor, permanent magnet, synchronous motor, and so on. Hard magnetic material generally used in the manufacture of the motors. Generally use the motor, brushless motor, synchronous motor, and difficult to magnetize this because of wide hysteresis loop. Example is hard magnetic material, iron, then cobalt, nickel, and gadolinium. GD is called gadolinium. Then soft magnetic material is very narrow hysteresis loop, low losses, hysteresis losses low, low coercive force, easy to magnetize and demagnetize. Therefore, it can be operated at very high switching frequency, but hard switching magnetic material will not operate high switching frequency. Soft magnetic material play an important role in easy to magnetize and demagnetize. Use in power electronic circuit, example, ferrite core, silicon ferrite, amorphous alloy, powder iron, nanocrystalline material, iron nickel, and iron cobalt. These are the different material. Then ferrite core, see here different type of ferrite core, E core, EC core, or ETD core, is cylinder core, then hollow cylinder core, then EC core, U type of core, toroidal core, or it is called ring core also sometime. These are different type of the ferrite cores, very commonly used by industry people because the low cost and high frequency operations in power electronic converter is highly used ferrite core, particularly transformer and inductor also. Then what is the advantages and disadvantages of the ferrite core here? So they are made from the iron oxide ferrite core, and the combined with the different material. So different material may be the copper, cobalt, magnesium, manganese, nickel, silicon, and zinc. These are the different material combined with the ferrite material. Typically, ferrite core having a flux density 0.25 to 0.45. But problem is, this is the higher side, but lower side design of inductor and transformer, it is considered 0.50. 0.15 is generally considered to design the inductor and transformer. Problem is of low flux density is saturated very easily. Even small DC current, it will saturate. Then high resistivity, very good. Resistivity is good. So the lower eddy current loss. So this is the good. Another problem. One is flux density. Another problem, low Curie temperature. This must be taken into account to design the inductor, particularly. So because of the low Curie temperature, operating temperature is very, very low as compared to the other core. then most commonly used type of ferrite core, manganese zinc and nickel zinc. These two material used for the ferrite core. So high electrical resistivity, nickel zinc having a high electrical resistivity, low eddy current loss, and more suitable frequency more than 1 MHz. Then manganese zinc, this is the nickel zinc, manganese zinc, low electrical resistivity, higher permeability, saturation flux density comparing to the nickel zinc is good. Good candidate for application below 1 MHz. Is good. This is above 1 MHz, above 1 MHz, so this is below 1 MHz. So different shape and sizes of the ferrite core. You can look into here. This is called pot core. Advantage of the pot core, you can see here. Winding is inside. Whether it is transformer or inductor, winding completely inside. This is the top portion and this is the bottom portion. Top and bottom portion, in between the top and bottom portion, there is a bobbin. Winding on the bobbin and then it is winding completely closed, bobbin and winding inside this part, completely surrounded by the ferrite core. So therefore, no leakage flux, very tight coupling. Magnetic coupling is very good in the pot core particularly. Only heat dissipation problem, that heat cannot dissipate it outside because of the closed path. We have to select the higher size ferrite core for the temperature. And also see the ferrite core temperature, operating temperature is lower compared to the other. Maybe 250 degrees centigrade maximum here. Then another type is PQ core. Then EE core. Then ETD core. The central part is cylindrical, circular, so it is called ETD, diameter type, so it is called ETD name. Then UC core, URC type of core, that is called UC core, and toroidal core, that sometimes it is called ring core also. There are different type of the cores are available, but ferrite cores. Other cores is also, will go one by one. Advantage of the ferrite core, smaller size for higher frequency. But another disadvantage, flux density is lower. If lower flux density, then saturation problem is very high. This is the problem with the ferrite core. Then powder core. The powder core is available in EE core, UC core, cylindrical core, toroidal core, and ring core also. There are large number of powder core. Now people are using now powder core. Powder core is nothing but the very small fine powder is compressing with the insulating material, compressed with the insulating material. So this insulating material, distributed air gap, generally in ferrite core use the air gap to avoid the saturation. So air gap use. Instead of using the air gap, what is here in powder core, distributed air gap. This insulating material mix with this powder, iron powder, air gap, insulating material, fine powder of insulating material mix with the fine powder of iron. That is, air gap is automatically distributed, no concentrated air gap. Generally in ferrite core and iron core, air gap used deliberately outside. The problem of air gap bulging out portion of the flux, that is called fringing, and leakage flux is also start. To avoid this, distributed air gap is used. What is the use of distributed air gap? The air gap, using the distributed air gap, you can operate at higher DC current. DC current you can pass through the inductor also. This is the advantages, because all converter, single-ended converter, for example, SMPS, and other converter, they are the all single ended converter, and DC current always present there. Powder core have a high resistivity, low hysteresis and current loss, good inductance stability under both the AC current and DC current operations. These are the advantages of the powder core. So if another advantage, inductance is stable over the wide range, that means wide temperature range, high saturation flux density. Another advantage, lack of localized air gap and no fringing effect, just I have told. Very high operating temperature, that is Curie temperature, the 450 degree centigrade. Effective permeability is in the range 15 to 550 effective permeability, because of air gap we are already distributed throughout the material. Basically, this powder core available in two-rider core there and EE core. There are another category of the powder core, that is Sender's core and MPP core, both available in toroidal and EE core. These are the very good cores, and we are using in our laboratory for the inverters operations and DC to DC converter operation. We are using these two type of the core, and is very good and stable. Operating frequency is also good. See the type of powder core now. What are the types? Very large number available as compared to earlier. Iron powder, generally this iron powder is called the amorphous core. Then Sender's core, it is also called Coulmo. Very good core, magnetic material, very, very good. Then MPP core, that is called molybdenum permeable powder, that is called the MONIFE. This very cost effective, is cost is more, but good stability, temperature stability, frequency stability, flux density is very, very good. High flux core, high flux tender core is made by using the aluminum, silicon and iron. High flux core, nickel and iron. X plus core, iron, silicon and boron. MO flux, iron and silicon. These are the different contents part of the powder core. These are the different powder cores. Now comparison of the different core in terms of saturation flux density, maximum operating temperature, this maximum operating temperatures, frequency, Curie temperature of ferrite core and powder core. So these are the comparison. Remember, this is not as per scale. This is not as per scale. Only flux density as per scale, other parameter only indicative parameter. This is not as per scale. So y-axis represent the flux density. X-axis represent the different type of magnetic material. And this vertical box is represent different parameters. For example, ferrite core. Ferrite core can operate very high switching frequency. Very, very high switching frequency. But problem is flux density is low. Very easily saturated when any amount of DC current will flow, even very small, this will saturate. And operating temperature only 250 degrees centigrade. Flux density low, frequency is good, operating temperature is low. Then come to the iron powder core. Iron powder means pure iron powder. This is called the amorphous core. Amorphous core is operate up to 200 kilohertz, maximum 200 kilohertz. And operating temperature is very, very good, 770 degrees centigrade, very, very good. Flux density is also good, 1.5 Weber per meter square. That is 1.5 Tesla. Another core, X plus core. In X plus core, operating frequency up to 500 kilohertz. Temperature is good. Flux density is near to the 1.6 Tesla. This is the very good advantages. But here only frequency is less. operating up to 500 kilohertz. If you are operating low frequency, then 500 below 200 100 kilohertz, this is the good core also. Then MPP core, that is the molybdenum permeable core, 2 megahertz operating, temperature is also good, and flux density is good. You can operate up to 0.8 tesla, very good flux density up to 0.8, very reliable core among the all core. All other benefit, operating frequency doesn't matter if 0.8 instead of 1.6, because you are operating at higher frequency, size is always less, size is inversely proportional to the frequency, and stability is very good for MPP. Then Sender's core is 2 megahertz, 500, and flux density is 1. This is also good. Then high flux core, 1 megahertz operating, temperature is good, flux density is 1.5. MO flux, good frequency, good temperature, good flux density is also here. Here, now you can see here why the size is inversely proportional to the frequency. Just I'll write one simple formula. Size is inversely proportional to frequency. So general care, you can see voltage equal to, for sine wave it is 4.41, but for square wave operation it is 4. The frequency up, then flux, phi, area into number of turns. If you draw this, that is equal to yep, area equal to, from this equation, area equal to V by 4 F pi into N. See here, this is area is inversely proportional to the frequency. V is a fixed, voltage is fixed, constant, flux is fixed in case of transformer. You already know maximum flux transformer is called constant flux device, flux is constant, number of turn is also constant. So therefore area is inversely proportional to the frequency. Higher the switching frequency, higher the frequency, lower the area of core. AC is the area of core. You got it? That is the advantages of the core, higher frequencies operations. So some problem is here, is not erasing. Okay, doesn't matter. So about this comparison of the core with the different parameters. Comparison of core with the different parameter. Next slide will show the DC bias performance characteristic or comparison. If you see the red color here, for DC current, performance of the ferrite core is very poor. If you go here, Sender's core is very good, better than the ferrite iron powder. MO flux, MPP is better than this. Then X flux, high flux, and X flux is higher than this. Why it is called high flux, X flux? Because it has a higher flux density. So therefore it is called high flux. So generally, Sender's, MPP, ferrite core, and iron powder, that is amorphous core, we are using. One care you have to take while using the transformer, you can use ferrite core for high frequency operation, because for transformer constant flux density. For inductor, flux density, flux is change. So it is a flux is constant, so no saturation problem for the AC supply. Not for DC, remember, for AC system only. For if you want to design inductor, you can use the either Sender's core or the MPP core for the transformer, no, for the inductor. Reason is, this is the distributed air gap and saturation problem is very less, and also higher flux density MPP and the sender core, including the iron powder loss. Core loss comparison of this core, for example, ferrite core, very rugged because of core losses, very high resistivity, that is core loss minimum, because green color is shown. So good resistivity, lower losses among the all core. MPP core, again lower losses, very very good core. Then senders, then X flux, iron powder is higher losses as compared to this. Losses is decreased according to this arrow. For losses, ferrite core is good because of, but for the transformer only. If you use the inductor and other thing, then senders and MPP core is good. Temperature stability point of view, we can look into the temperature stability, very poor for the iron and ferrite core, good for senders, high flux, MPP is good, better than the all core, stability wise. Okay. Then comparison of this different type of core, comparison at a one glass. In a glance, you can see here comparison. Material, different type of material, MO flux, high flux, senders, MPP, X flux, iron powder and ferrite core. Similarly here, different parameter of the material, that is the core loss, DC bias, relative cost, saturation flux density, Curie temperature, operating frequency and temperature stability. Only conditions. Now look at this MO flux, start from the MO flux. The core loss is low. Low core loss is a good, but DC bias is better. Okay, this is also good, better, but relative cost is medium. Medium relative cost. So that is the problem, medium cost. If cost is no problem, you can go. Saturation flux density 1.2, very good. Curie temperature 400, very good. Operating frequency 2 megahertz. Temperature stability is better. In all parameter, MO flux is meet the criteria. But remember, core loss is low. It is not a very low or negligible. It is a low. DC bias is better. Is any core is better than this core is available than the MO flux? See the I flux. Core loss is moderate here, not a low or very low, is a moderate. But DC bias is best. DC bias is best in the high flux. Relative cost is medium. Flux density is very good, 1.2. Temperature is also good. Frequency is good. Temperature stability is better, very good. All parameter is meeting. Only problem is the moderate core loss is high. And this is also relative cost is also slightly. And let us come with the core, sender score now. Low. Core loss is low. DC bias is good. Here the DC bias is best, but here is good. Relative cost is the low. Here medium, but here is low. Parameter is mid. DC bias parameter mid. Relative cost also mid. What is the flux density now? One is also good for a high frequency operation, is very good one flux density. Even our simple iron is one is considered for design of inductor and transformer. Even machine design, instead of 1.5, will consider one. So sender score is also good. This also parameter is meeting. Curie temperature is very good. So operating frequency is good. Temperature stability is also good. All those parameter meeting by the meet the sender score. Therefore, we are using the sender score in the laboratory. Then in addition to the sender scores, we are using MPP core. Why? Reason is core loss very negligible. Negligible core loss. DC bias is better. relative cost is the only problem here. Relative cost. If cost is not a problem for development, so you can use the MPP core. Other because reason is, in the cost of ferrite core is which cheaper, in the cost of one sanders core you can buy 10 ferrite core, in the cost of one sanders core you can buy 10 ferrite core, in the cost of one MPP core you can buy 100 ferrite core. This is the cost difference. Cost is very high. Flux density is very good, Curie temperature is also good, this is also, and temperature stability is the best among the all core. So therefore these two core is all the best. Then PX flux high, core loss is high, so cannot be used for high base. Relative cost is low, very good. Flux density is C, very high. It should be green color or blue color, it should not be red, so it's wrongly placed. Temperature stability is very good. The operating frequency is okay, not good but okay. Stability is good. Iron powder core loss is the highest. DC bias is good. Relative cost is lowest, no problem. Flux density is good. Temperature is good. This is the problem. But if you perform actually temperature stability is very poor. Temperature stability size is poor. And the core loss is poor, very high. This is the problem with the amorphous core, that is the iron powder. Another type of ferrite ore that is very commonly used is the lowest. Core loss is lowest, DC bias is poor, relative cost is lowest, saturation flux is poor, Curie temperature, operating frequency, and temperature stability. So next is carbonyl iron powder core. Carbonyl iron powder. This is also one of the best core again, but used for different applications. Carbonyl iron powder core or the carbonyl iron core are obtained by heating the carbonyl iron, FeCO5. Higher permeability, relative permeability 1 to 50. Hysteresis losses is very high. Low hysteresis losses at very high switching frequency of approximately 10 MHz. Can be used for the high frequency application, this type of core, carbonyl iron. Quality factor is very good, very, very high. Q equal to J omega L by R, very high. Frequency above 150 megahertz. This can be used. Very high frequency. Main application of this type of the core, carbonyl iron powder core, used generally electromagnetic interference and radio frequency interference device, where the high linearity radio current sensing devices generally used. Then amorphous core, this is look like a glass structure and very good core, generally used for filter design. There are some advantage of this core also, and this core is made up of using ferromagnetic material like metallic element like silicon, boron and carbon. Look like a glass structure, that is called metallic glass. Relative permeability is very high, more than 150,000. This is the advantage here, because a filter is operating at low frequency generally, because to block the high frequency component and pass the low frequency component inductor particularly. So permeability is very high, and this is very essential for conductivity of the flux. Therefore size of filter requirement is reduced. Saturation flux density is very, very good, 0.7 to 1.8 is the saturation flux density. But only problem, is the temperature goes from 25 to 250 degrees centigrade. Saturation fluxancy reduced by 30% or more. Temperature is rise, so saturation fluxancy should decrease. That is the problem. And the lower temperature stability, temperature, operating temperature, not stability, operating temperature is lower. So this type of core, there are two manufacturing, that is the med glass, vitro glass, commonly available. Maximum operating frequency for this amorphous core is 250 kilohertz. Above this you cannot be operate. Usually available in the U and toroidal core. Used for pulse transformer, current transformer, switch mode power supply, power correction factor at the choke. You can use for this purpose. This is the advantages of this type of core. Generally used for the filter design, and where the filter device means the generally inverter used as a FET device, then inverter followed by the inductors, three-phase inductor, that is used by the amorphous core, using amorphous core and connected to the grid, or the inverter followed by the filter and the connector to the motor drive also, where the size is matter. So the amorphous core generally used. There another type of core that is called nanocrystalline core. In nanocrystalline core, generally large number of electricity boards or MSCBB electricity board use this type of core for manufacturing the CT and PT. Very good flux density, very good core, very good stability also. This nanocrystalline material made up of physical size 7 to 20 nanometer. 7 to 20 nanometer iron core. Addition to the iron powder, very fine powder, you can see here 7 to 20 nanometer fine powder. In addition to the traces, this, that means the fine powder, they will use silicon material, boron material, and the copper also, and molybdenum material and niobium material. So nanocrystalline material, very costly. This also costly core because of this molybdenum and niobium, very costly material in corresponding to the silicon, boron and copper. These are the cheap, but this molybdenum and niobium is their costly. So this core is also costly. Generally CTPT manufacturer are used. They are, this core is made specially for the CTPT. Amorphous core is also used, no doubt, but nanocrystalline has a special element and special core because operating temperature is also good. They are combined with the high saturation flux density of silicon. These are combined, these traces, in addition to the high silicon, high flux density silicon with low loss ferrite and at high temperature. Ferrite is also added here. Small amount of ferrite is also added. Saturation flux density around 1.2 to 1.5 Tesla. Very good saturation flux density for the nanocrystalline material. Core use up to the frequency. This core use up to the frequency of the 150 kHz operating range. Specially used in the current transformer manufacture, pulse transformer, common mode EMI filter. For this purpose, generally it is used. These are the references for the magnetic material. There are two manufacturers generally, magnetic and med glass. You can note down if you want this magnetic material reference side. You go to the site and see the different data books. You will get the magnetic material. Maybe Sender's core, MPP core, high flux core, and the ferrite core, then the nanocrystalline material, MR first core, all core is available. Magnetic is very good. Made glass is also good. Or you can go to the CRC press book. This press, Vachu, Vinslia, Kyo. These two authors are there. They are written this book, Inductor and Transformer, a Power Electron. Kazimari and Kazimarchuk also is there. High frequency magnetic material book. Then Meckelmann and Meckelmann Cologne. Also, one is the book. Then Hurley, William G. This is also another book. But these are the practical data you will get here. In addition to this, if you want the detail, you can refer this book about this. Then this is about this magnetic material. Then we'll go to the some different converter also. Small idea for the converters also. So I will stop here sharing and open the new PCB, new this for the magnetic material. And I'll stop here sharing. Wait few minutes.
Yes, sir.
Wait. I am opening.
Yeah, sir. No problem.
So I will show the some PPT, SIC inverter, how we'll develop practically. This is very useful for the students also.
Okay.
Visible?
Yes, sir.
See here, we have developed in laboratory. A diode clamp three-level inverter we have developed in the laboratory using silicon carbide device. And the efficiency is very, very high. It's more than 99%. Very good. I am showing just how to develop, how to take care for designing the hardware. Therefore, I am showing here. So see here, three level inverters, output DC is input and output A, B, C is the output. See here, this three level inverter, how many IGBT? 4 IGBT in one leg, total is 12 IGBT and the 1, 2, 6 diode. Total component is 12 plus 6, 18 component and 2 capacitor, 18 plus 2, 20 components are there. And 20 component if you mount including the heat sink, devices, it will go the weight is nearly 5 to 10 kg including heat sink. See how one side you have to reduce this size of circuit, that is the increase the power density. Power density means higher the power density means smaller the size. So we are going here to design converter. Earlier we can see here, this is the converter. We have inverter three phase 20 kilowatt inverter we have developed in the laboratory. Is the DSP, this DC split capacitor. This is the component here to reduce the wiring inductance. Capacitor is connected across each DC bus. There are three DC bus here. And this is the DC, red, common. This is the common and this is the another 3 DC bus, 1, 2 and 3 DC bus. So component you can see here, these are the IGBT here, lower side here, the below PCB IGBT is there. And this is the control circuit, this is the DSP and all the circuit. But here the common heatsink use, very big heatsink use. Problem with the big heatsink, the size is very high. Not high, is the bulky, little bulky. But we don't want bulky. See here, how the device is mounted. These are the devices. 1, 2, 3 devices, 4 devices, so on. So these devices mounted, their terminal. Device terminal is brought on the PCB. Devices is here. and this is the PCB brought on that. To reduce the wiring inductance, to reduce the spike at the gate of the devices, we are blocked this, and this is the gate driver circuit near. This is gate to source resistance. This is also gate to source, yes, resistance. And this is the two driver IC. We have used the Micril MEC. You have to remember Micril MEC, optocoupler for isolation. The problem with the common heat sink, what is the problem? The internal capacitance, heat sink capacitance and device capacitance is coming into the contact in the picture. And the spike will increase the current spike and voltage spike, lot of noise is there. So many manufacturer use the common heat sink to save the cost of the heat sink. But what we have done, because losses is very less in silicon carbide devices, we have replaced this. See here, gate driver circuit is mounted directly here on the PCB. This is the power part, and this is the control part, driver circuit. This is the waveform, voltage waveform, and the current waveform. See here, these are the spike. When the device is off, during off condition, the spike should not be here because of common heat swing between the capacitance and devices. See here also. So this should not be there. See here, noise. This should not be. But here, this is the gate pulses. This is the voltage across device. See, voltage across device, spike will come. This spike is not externally visible, but internally, if you see the device voltage, this is visible. Many inverter I have checked in the laboratory, this similar type of spike is available. Because they are not bothered about the spike and other. They use the large devices. Instead of small devices, use the lot. Suppose 50 ampere is required current, they will use some 500 ampere device or 200 ampere device. Very high D rating use to protect the device. So you have to take proper care for design of the converters. For example, see here the output voltage. If the internally it is visible, if you see externally, output voltage, line to line voltage and line current, line to line current is very smooth. It's not visible, but it is in the device, and this very, very harmful to the device, and device may be damaged many times. Because of these, many inverters generally fail. See here our silicon carbide. We have replaced complete inverter with the different heat sink. See here, individual heat sink, very small heat sink use. These are the device 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. And in between these diode, clamp diode, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. This is the clamp diode. And see the clamp diode here. Okay. So here gate driver circuit. These are the all gate driver for individual silicon carbide MOSFET. And this on single PCB is weight is only 1 kg. Only 1 kg weight. For 20 kVA inverter, 1 kg weight. This is the output RYB, input plus neutral and minus. These are the, will be given to the inverter. Very compact, small, developed in the lab and is connected to the grid. It's connected to the grid also. See the gate driver circuit, each gate driver and device all are surface mounting technology. Reason to decrease the noise, See here, this is the ferrite bead to decrease the oscillation at the gate of the device. Earlier you have shown the oscillation to reduce the ferrite bead. This is the resistances, gate resistances. This is gate to source resistance. And this is the gate driver. Two are the gate driver circuits to drive to the MOSFET. And this is the optocoupler. 6N137 optocoupler. Rectifier is also used here only. This rectifier supply the power to the gate. And pulse will come from the DSP here. See, that is the reason is very, very small size. Now you see the back side. This is the front side, and if you see the back side, this capacitor is connected small between the DC link to to reduce the noise due to this wire, this track, shear track, to reduce the noise. Also, to discharge this capacitor is connected. To discharge capacitor, some resistance is added immediately to discharge the capacitor. Even when the inverter suddenly off, this capacitor is remains charged. To discharge the capacitor, so resistances are used on backside. So this is the complete setup. This complete setup so useful for this complete setup, DC power supply, DSP, and this is main, that is the inverter is connected to the grid. This is the output voltage and output current, line to line voltage and phase current. This blue is phase voltage, this line to line voltage, and this is the current. See here, no noise here. Even device also, see here, voltage. This line to line voltage and corresponding current. Line voltage and phase current. See the voltage across the device. See the voltage across device. Sorry, output voltage and current, sinusoidal current. No filter. This is without filter. Remember that. No filter is connected here in between the inverter and a grid. So this is the voltage. See here, device gate pulse, voltage across the device. See. Even at 83 kilohertz, remember, 20 kVA inverter operated at 83 kilohertz. So no noise here, smooth current and voltage. See here is also smooth, very small is present, that is always present. You cannot eliminate completely. Gate pulses, see gate pulses, how smooth are gate pulses because of ferrite bit we have used. This is the ferrite bit we have used, come to the hardware. This ferrite bit. We have taken all precaution to protect the circuit and to control the connected grid. Various method we have used to control the grid. Droop method we have used to control for the grid. Then the master slave method we have used to control the grid. And the after master slave, one is the master, another is the slave. And then modified master slave method used to control grid. After that, how to connect to the grid? There is a difficult parameter. We have to take the proper care. To connect to the grid, you need the PLL phase lock loop to synchronization to generate the angle theta to synchronize the voltage between your grid and your inverters. So you need the PLL, and this PLL is also designed in the same PCBs, in the same hardware circuit, that is the same here, same DSP. Or you can use DSP with the combination of the FPGA also you can use, doesn't matter, whatever you want to use, you can use. So this is the, just I have shown how to develop, how to manufacture the inverters. Just different slide I have shown. My aim to learn something, how to design. Generally, students and faculty design trial and error method. Okay, you can design trial and method, doesn't matter, but you have to take proper care while designing also. Doesn't matter trial and error, but you have to take the proper care. Wiring is very tight. There should not be loose wire. See in the PCB, any loose wire here? No loose wire here. See here? No loose wire. Because this is the main part to transmit power from source to load and connected to the grid. Power control through the inverter is controlled using the DSP and the feedback. How much power to be fed to the load is depend upon your control sensing signal or how much power to be fed available. And see the how the tight power density here, very tight converter. Similarly, we have developed also DC to AC converter also. Sorry, DC to DC converter also in similar manner. Is very small structure. And this is overall about is the lecture. Now, any lectures you can ask me. Any questions you can ask me. This is about the end of the lectures. Now, your time now for the question answer.
Hello.
Hello. tell.
One question is asked that what about the loss for this model that you have designed, that is diode clamp three level in inverter. What about the loss?
Loss is very less. See, the losses depend upon I square R. R is very, very small. You know the whatever IGBT here, sorry, MOSFET we have used for this MOSFET. So this MOSFET resistance, onset resistance is negligible. 13 milliohm, 13 milliohm. So I square R is negligible. Right? Have you got it?
Yes.
R is very, very small, 13 milliohm only, and switching losses is very not very, very less. Because of this is very high speed devices, switching losses is minimum, is also negligible, very small. So that the efficiency is more than 99%. You can see the data book, Cree manufacturer, Cree develop this. Device is developed by the Cree. You can go to the Cree. It is the 90 ampere device, 90 ampere 1200 volt device, 90 ampere 1200 volt device, and you can see 13 milliohm only resistance.
Okay, so I hope Santana sir has got the answer for this question.
Okay, any question?
Next question is what is the percentage of carbonate that is dropped in the silicon to make this MOSFET?
Carbonate? What is the question?
Question
what
is asked the... by Mr. Niranjan. Yes. What is the percentage of carbonate?
Carbonate. Silicon carbide device. This is the different material, special silicon carbide material. Silicon with the carbide, not a carbon. Silicon carbide material. This is the semi, similar to the semiconductor device. This is the nanotechnology material, different material. It's similar to the silicon material. But it is silicon carbide. It is operated at very high temperature with very good bandwidth. Wide bandwidth.
One question is that how much temperature rise in MOSFET on full load power conversion in clamped three level indicator in inverter?
So see heatsink size here, very small heatsink, and this is tested at full load 20 kVA. So losses is negligible. There is no temperature rise here, very less temperature rise. We have run continuously two hour we have run continuously using 20 kVA connected to the grid. So no losses, no temperature rise, but therefore heatsink is raised. But this device is operate at 250 degree centigrade. Silicon MOSFET is operate 150 degree centigrade. This device can go up to the 250 degree centigrade also. This is the advantages of the device.
Okay. And sir, one question is there. What is the PWM technique used in this circuit?
Here is the sinusoidal PWM. Sinusoidal PWM used to connect to the grid. Ultimate way to connect to grid.
Next is what is the use of DSP in this circuit?
DSP used for controlling DS. In DSP you can write the program. For pulse width modulation you can write the program. Here event manager also, and input output ports. So we have used the input output port, not the event manager. Event manager two available. So eight pin output for one single event manager, total is 16 output is available, is sufficient for 12 devices. But we have used the input output port to get the pulses from this. You can generate the sine wave, you can generate the carrier also, and compare the carrier and a sine wave in the DSP itself, and output pulses you will get in the south.
One last question we will take. How to calculate the rating of multi-level inverter?
Rating that depend upon the current and voltage. So voltage rating, current rating. The noise, some problem is coming. The noise, sound is repeating. Okay, doesn't matter. So here, voltage rating you have selected. Suppose your operating voltage is 440 volt. For 415 volt, right? Let us see 400 volt. Are you getting or not? Hello.
Yes, sir. We are getting. Yes,
400 volt. What is the peak value of 400 volt? Maybe 600 volt. 600 volt is peak value. So you can select the device above 600. So you have to derate 50% to 60%. So definitely you can use 1200 volt device. 1000 volt to 1200 volt device. That is there. If suppose current rating is, for example, 20 kilowatt, what is the current rating for 20 kilowatt? For example, 30 ampere, right? For 30 ampere current rating, you have to select the 60 to 70 ampere device. We have selected 90 ampere device. Okay. For load current, for example, 30 ampere. So you have to select more than 30 ampere. So we have selected maybe a 90 ampere device. There are two rating of the device. There are two rating of the device. One is the peak rating and one is the one is 30 degree temperature device or 25 centigrade degree rating, and the one is the 150 degree centigrade rating, current rating particularly. So you select 150 degree centigrade rating. So that may be a 60 ampere rating for the device. So we have selected instead of 30 ampere, we have selected 60 ampere, that is 90 ampere peak current approximately. Okay.
Yes, sir. Yes. Can we take one more question?
Yes, you can take number of multiple questions. No problem.
Okay. One question is asked that if reference voltage has itself harmonics or distortion, is any it will affect on generation voltage?
Yes, is affect. So you have to program for the reference voltage. What about in DSP? ADCs are available, A to D converters. You sense those current or voltage and average it by averaging or filter, digital filter available in DSP. You can use the digital filter. No external filter is required. Okay?
Yes, sir. One question is, one student, I think this question is asked that if a 12 pulse converter is to be designed for 15 kilowatt load, which type of switching devices they can use?
What is the power rating, 12 pulse power rating?
15 kilowatt.
15 kilowatt. So if you see the cost also important factor. So IGBT is the best devices and good devices. You can go the IGBT because the silicon MOSFET. Silicon carbide MOSFET having very high costly. So at the time of when we have purchased, this is a 4000. Now maybe it will get in 3000 each devices. So 12 devices, very costly. So you can go IGBT, maybe 200 to 500 each pieces will come. So you go to the IGBT, is a very good devices. Now high speed IGBT is also available, no doubt. Is a good IGBT is also.
One question is that can the multi-level inverter helpful in increasing the efficiency of power supply?
Depend upon your conditions. Where you are using for motor load or any other load, depend upon your load also. Multi-level you can use, no doubt. Good filter size is reduced for multi-level converters. You can use multi-level, but three level is the good, better than other, because the component is less as compared to the five level converter. So you can use multi-level inverter, is good, no problem. Any other question?
I think one question is that can you describe more about snubber circuit? So within few lines.
Snubbers in inverter, snubber circuit is not required at all. That is the reason. If snubber is required, noise is coming. That is means your wiring problem. So no snubber is required. Only in hard switching, maybe DC to DC converter may be required, but in inverter is not required at all. wiring is important, is required. See our converter, deliberately I have shown this converter. See the wiring, no wiring at all. Even we have taken care. See here, if you small wiring track, we have taken here care. This capacitor is connected to reduce the wiring inductance also. So therefore, no wiring inductance. And capacitance also reduced. So therefore, noise is reduced, not snubber leak is required. Traces is very less. Okay.
Okay, sir. Yes. A lot of questions are there, but we are having time constraint. We'll forward this question to you, sir, after some time, so that you can answer it. Okay.
Whatever you are recorded today is shared with Google Drive. Okay.
Yes, sir. Yes, definitely.
Okay. Good. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for this resourceful session, very knowledgeable session. I'm sure that participants have found it very interesting and incredibly useful. Okay. So, sir has explained so many points regarding the design of converters, that is specifications of converters, selection of power electronic switches, selection of magnetic materials, various types of magnetic material and their selection, and design of gate driver circuit, and so many things are told by the sir. So students and many researchers, students will get the benefit of this, all the things, I think. So thank you very much, sir, once again. I think all the students and all the participants are benefited. I request all the participants to join the session again.
Can I leave now? 3 o'clock,
sir. Yes, sir.
Can I leave?
Yes, sir, you can leave, sir.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Hello. I request all the participants to join again at 3 p.m. sharp. The next session will start at 3 p.m. Okay. Dr. Ritesh Kesri will deliver the session on electrical vehicles. So, see you all of you at 3 o'clock once again. Thank you very much for this session.